positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement both increase the behavior in question. So, but if you're on your test question and you see a question about this kind of thing, you're like, man, that's operant conditioning for sure. First thing you want to do is say, what behavior are we talking about? Does it go up or does it go down? If it goes up, if it's increased or maintained, it's been reinforced. It's keeping on going. Why does shoe tying keep on happening? Because it becomes self-reinforcing. If it stopped being reinforcing, you would expect shoe tying behavior to diminish. I can ride a bike, but it's been a lot of years. But if I get on a bike, I'll be a little probably unsteady at first, not having done it for years, but I bet I'll get it back quickly. It'll reestablish pretty quickly. Negative reinforcement and positive reinforcement shouldn't be considered good and bad. People totally screw up when they start thinking it means good and bad. Think of it mathematically. It means adding and subtracting. Positive reinforcement. The response is increased, that's reinforcement, due to the presentation of a pleasurable stimulus after the response. Something is added to the situation that the organism likes. The organism might be a rat, a pigeon, a dog. You can go down to SeaWorld and watch them train all kinds of interesting, right, mammals that swim, and people. So if the response goes up, it's reinforcement. If it's because the consequence was pleasurable to the organism, then it's positive reinforcement. If the response is increased due to the removal of an unpleasant stimulus, well, it's still reinforcement because the response is increased, but now it's taking away something from the situation, negative, as in subtracting something that the organism doesn't like. One of my favorite examples, you remember this, but not most of these people, but back in the day when they first tried to get people to use seat belts, people just didn't use them. They thought it was ludicrous, so the data supported that you should wear it. So public health measures were undertaken, laws were written, and engineering solutions were designed where when you got into a car, it would go, an aversive stimulus would be terminated if you buckled your seatbelt. So what did people learn to do more quickly? Buckle the seatbelt to prevent the aversive stimulus. So seatbelt buckling went up because it took away an unpleasant stimulus, right? Now when people go, well, I tried giving him reinforcement, but it didn't work, then they're probably trying to treat an individual like a group. People don't have time, especially in education, like, I can't treat all these 30 kids individually. I would suggest that not only do you have time, but that if you do so, you will save yourself tremendous amounts of time finding out what reinforces some kids. Gold stars work for some kids. They don't work for some kids, right? So you have to figure out what a kid is valuing to see what will reinforce them for it to be effective. Some kids don't like buzzers. Some kids will go making crazy noises that will drive us all nuts, right? So what's aversive to one kid may not be aversive to another kid. Punishment, now we got the response decreasing and we've got positive and negative punishment. If the response is decreased, it's punishment. If it goes down, it's punishment. Now, if it was because you presented an unpleasant stimulus as a consequence, now you're adding that to the situation, right? As such, now we have positive punishment. If it's because the consequence removes something pleasurable from the organism, then you've got negative punishment. So here's a couple situations for you. So if I got a kid and he's throwing spitballs in class, and I say, you're going to the principal's office right now, I'm punishing the kid. Well, he kept on doing it. Well, if he kept on doing it, you didn't punish the kid. Spanking is positive punishment if it works. I didn't say it was a good thing to do, right? If a kid is doing something and the parent says stop doing it, they keep doing it, and the parent now applies an aversive stimulus, they have added that as a consequence. That's the positive part. It just means it's added. If the kid stops doing it, in other words, if the response decreases, then it was punishment. But if the kid does it again and keeps on doing it, then it was by definition reinforcement. Some kids being so starved of attention will take negative, right? Not negative, right? They'll take what we consider to be bad attention over no attention at all, right? So you tell this kid, you better stop the spitballs. You go to the principal's office. This kid goes, all right then, goes out down the hall, takes a while to get to the principal's office, gets to the principal's office, I'm supposed to see the principal. Principal's not in. Is the principal ever in? Nope, sit down. Principal's busy. Killing time. Principal finally comes, busy, says, "What'd you do? Don't do that again or you're getting in trouble." All right. Goes back down the hall. Now the kid is coming back in. He keeps throwing spitballs. Teacher's exasperated. "I don't know what to do with him. I punished him." No, you didn't. Right? The classroom situation, the kid's throwing spitballs. He's getting laughter. Right? Presentation of positive consequences, right? So he's going, "Oh yeah, people are laughing." Doesn't like being in the aversive classroom. You just removed him from the aversive classroom. You had the opposite intended effect because you didn't really understand behavior. And most people don't understand this. So instead of blaming themselves for misapplications of very straightforward principles, they blame the kids for failing to conform to their expectations for what should happen. So if you raise kids or teach kids, you should know this stuff. It depends on the target behavior. Figure out what you want to go up or what you want to go down, and its direction, whether it's going up or going down, and whether a stimulus was removed or applied. There's just some examples outside of that. Positive reinforcement. You turn in your homework on time. Teacher praises you. Gives you a dollar? No, not necessarily. Could give you a gold star, or could just say, "Great job, thanks for bringing that in." Makes you feel good, if it makes you feel good, right? If it doesn't, then it might not be effective reinforcement, right? But if it does, then the kid's probably going to turn in homework on time again, meaning it's been positively reinforced because you presented this pleasurable consequence. Got a headache. Headache's aversive. There's your contingency. If I take an aspirin, and if that aspirin makes my headache go away, then in similar situations in the future when I have a headache, I'm more likely to take an aspirin, right? Because it's negatively reinforcing. It removes an aversive stimulus to do the behavior more. Positive punishment. You don't clean up your room when your parents ask you to. Your parent yells at you. That's aversive, right? They don't like being yelled at, these kids. Well, what if they don't care? Then it wouldn't be a very effective behavior change strategy, right? But if it works and the kid then stops dawdling and cleans up the room, right, what's happening there? The non-cleaning is going down and cleaning is going up, so it depends on how you define it, right? If I get pulled over and given a ticket and I'm pulled over in front of my workplace and I have colleagues go by and see me getting pulled over and I stop speeding in that area or stop running that red light, was it because they added embarrassment or because they added a ticket or a delay, or is it because they removed money from my wallet when I had to pay the fine? It could be both. Yes, exactly. Usually lots of things are in operation, but very few people take the time to pull them apart like this. So really what we're talking about is understanding that you're looking at a target behavior and you're analyzing it. Applied behavior analysis has great, great impact on lots of areas of life, not the least of which include the treatment of autism and teaching children, et cetera. And I gave you this little graph right here for your own helpfulness. You get into my test, you can use a scratch paper, right? Drop down this little thing and you'll get, doesn't matter what question you get, you'll know exactly what the answer is because you'll go, "Well, what behavior are we talking about? What's the target behavior and what's the consequence? If the behavior's going up, it's reinforcement, correct? Behavior goes down, it's punishment. No matter what we thought it was going to do, whatever it did is how we label it. If I'm applying a stimulus and the behavior's going up, it's positive reinforcement. If I'm applying a stimulus and the behavior is going down, it's positive punishment. If I'm removing a stimulus and the behavior is going up, it's negative reinforcement. And if I'm removing a stimulus and the behavior is going down, it's negative punishment." It's that simple, but if you don't know it that well, it'll easily confuse you as a parent, as a teacher, as a person taking a test, as a person working with employees. This happens everywhere, believe me. Right? We are all reinforced for things and punished for things, and we get our behavior shaped as a result. If you get a raise, maybe you're more likely to do what got you the raise. If you get a pay deduction, maybe you're less likely to do certain kind of work behaviors to compensate for that. So it's applying to all of our lives. There's some pretty amazing applicability to this information, and you have this in your notes. Now, check out this slide here. Thank you. There's a lot we could say about punishment, but in the interest of time, we won't go into great detail about punishment. But are you writing stuff right now? Are you circling stuff right now? Or have you already read this slide and read the bottom where it said, in white font, are you right now behaving in a manner consistent with previous reinforcement of writing down white fonted material? Ah! He said, I'm not a rat. I'm not a pigeon. You can't condition me to do stuff. I found that out by accident once where I was really not very savvy with PowerPoints. And the second PowerPoint or whatever came up in the sequence, and like everything came up, and there was some white font stuff on the bottom. I was talking about what was on top, and everybody went, I'm like, I'm not talking about that yet. But I couldn't override the conditioning. I couldn't, me telling them I'm trying to stay up at the top of the slide didn't make them stay at the top of the slide. The conditioning told them to go where? To where the reinforcement is. This is the information I need for my test. That's where I'm going. Boom. I said, wow, that's a powerful demonstration. And if you'd already read that slide, you might go, ah, I see what you were going to do. Punishment rules, apply it quickly after the behavior, use the lowest effective level, be consistent, give an explanation appropriate to the age, always reinforce alternative desired behaviors, use physical punishment rarely and carefully, because otherwise they just learn to escape you or avoid you, and you model some pretty maladaptive coping strategies. If you use physical punishment harshly and arbitrarily, what it implies to the kid receiving it is, as an adult, when I don't know what to do, I hit people. So guess what the kid is more likely to do? Kids with high levels of physical punishment are more likely to use physical aggression in school. It's not that you can't use it, it's that you need to be careful about it, you need to be consistent with it, you use the lowest possible level of it, then as soon as they're able to start getting their behavior modified by other consequences, like taking away of privileges, or toys, or whatever, telephone, or driving rights, or whatever it is, those should be used instead of physical punishment, because they're more effective in the long run for a lot of reasons, and they don't come with the side effects.